Hi everybody, my name is Tom Zickel, and today we're going to talk a bit about the CPython bytecode and how to inject code into it. So we'll first talk a bit about the bytecode system and the code objects, and then I'll show a framework I've written called Bytehook, which allows you to insert function calls into pre-existing code without preparations. Then I'll show another cool project called Pyrocyte, which actually allows you to inject Python code into running live processes. And then I'll show a combination of both of them to maybe allow you to debug already running servers without previous preparations if you want to look at issues as there are. And this talk is mostly based on the CPython 2 conventions, but most of the stuff is just a name change in CPython 3. So the problem I'm trying to solve basically is on the left side, I have here a simple program which run in an endless loop, and it does some computation. You can try to think of your code actually running there. And then you run it, and on the right, once in a while, you get an exception, and you're not sure what's going on, and you want, without taking down the program, to look what is going on. Let's start in the beginning. Why are we talking about bytecode? Well, actually, CPython, when it runs your Python code, it actually really knows how to only execute the bytecode, and not the source code that you write. And if you want to modify the code, as we'll see, you need to understand how actually the bytecode system works. And for those of you who don't know what the bytecode is, so basically, it's another form of instruction set that it's designed for efficient execution by the software interpreter. So it basically takes your source code and it figures out all the scope, the nesting of the functions, the semantic analysis, and it translates it into the bytecode. So yeah, actually, CPython has also, it's not just an interpreter, there is a compilation part. Whenever you type stuff in your interactive shell, you import some source code, or you run the compile command, CPython actually compiles your code. The output of the compilation step is something called the code object. And the code object can actually be serialized to disk. You probably know the PYC files. So it uses something that's a bit like the Pickle protocol, but it's called the Marshall protocol because it's not guaranteed to be backward compatible. To turn the code object into a file representation. And you have projects like uncompile, which can actually do the right thing and take your PYC file and get back the original PY file. The bytecode itself, it's not a part of the language specification, and it can actually change a bit between versions. And if you want to learn about the compilation stages, there is in the developer's guide a chapter called Design of the CPython Compiler. Okay, so what is this code object that the compiler produces? It's actually a representation of the byte-compiled executable Python code. The code object itself cannot be run by the interpreter. It needs a context, which it doesn't include, about which global variables exist in the code, which you might refer to them in the function. So there is something called the function object, which it actually contains the code object and an explicit reference to the function globals. Also, all the default arguments you may put in your code, they are stored in the function object and not in the code object, because this stuff is actually calculated in the runtime when you run the code. And unlike function objects, the code object are immutable, and they can't contain any references to mutable objects. So here on the top, I define the function f with an argument a and the default value 1, and it returns it. So if we look at the type of f, we can see it's type of a function object. And if we look inside f and func code, each type it's actually the code object. And in the attribute dictionary of f, we can see there is the function closure if you have nested functions, the code object, the default arguments, the global namespace, the doc string, etc. And if you look at the function func code, you actually can see a different list of attributes. If you want to see how the bytecode looks, so on the left, on the top, I define the Fibonacci function in the Python interpreter. And then in Python, you have a built-in model called this, which actually disassembles the bytecode into something you can look at. So in the bottom left part, we actually see what does a code object contain. It has the function name, in which filename it was defined, how many arguments it has in its input, how much keyword are on the arguments there are, how many local variables. It also computes the stack size the function needs to run. There's some flags, like if it has a star argument or star keyword argument inputs, which constants are used actually inside the code. So in the Fibonacci, you can see there are three constants, none, one, and two. And which variables are used? Here you can see there is only one. The constants and the variables are tuples. And on the right, you can actually see the disassembly of how the bytecode looks in a human readable form. So if we look on the right part, the left side, you have the line number. So you can see each line number from the Fibonacci, how it's translated to the bytecode. You have you can see in the middle, jump target. So it's actually which bytecode is a jump target inside the function. And then you have inside the bytecode the different indexes of each of the opcodes that are ran. Then you have the actual opcodes inside the function. Some opcodes can have one optional argument of 2 bytes. So you can see their translation here to a number. The disassembly module also shows you their meaning. So just a quick look. If we look in the Fibonacci, the first line is if n is less than or equal 1, we can see on the right side, it actually is translated to you do a load fast of variable 0 in the variable tuple 0, which is actually loads the variable n into the stack. And then it loads the constant 1 into the stack. Then the compare operation bytecode of type 1, which is actually means less than equal, actually pops the 2 elements up from the stack and compares them, and it puts in the stack the result, it's true or false. And then you see the if is translated into a pop jump if false. So if the comparison evaluated to false, it will jump to bytecode indices 16 and continue executing from there. Or if it's true, it will just do a load const 1 and return value, which exits the function. So the interpreter part of CPython, it actually takes the function object. It builds a frame object, which that includes all the information that it's needed to execute the function, the locals, globals, variables, the built-in variables, all the exception information, where exactly it's currently running inside the bytecode. Then there's in the Python source code a huge function called pyeval, eval frame ex. It actually takes the code object string, and it has a giant switch which has all of the opcodes, and for each opcode in the string, it executes its effect. Also important to note is the virtual machine of the CPython, it's stack-based, not register-based. That's why all the opcodes I talked about, they do modification on the stack. And the global interpreter lock can actually only be switched between opcodes, not while a thread is executing in the middle of an opcode. Okay, now let's talk a bit about bytehooks. Actually, Python module, which I've written, and allows you to insert function calls from Azure function calls via hook points. And it does that by manipulating the code object. You can insert or disable or remove them completely. And my motivation actually was I had a code I wanted to insert debugging code into it because it was running in a server and there were issues. And I didn't know where the server would have exceptions. So I wanted a way to do it in live without taking down the server. And I'm using a cool project I'll just show, Pyrocyte, which actually injects the bytehooks into a running process. You can find the link here later for the project. And it's currently more of a research project. It's not production ready. And let's take a look at a simple example. So on the left side, I have here code. And let's just look at the bold part. Actually, I run a function called test, which prints from 0 to 3. And on the right side, you can see the output. There is a first try. And then it has 0, 1, 2, 3. Then I define a function called odd or even, which actually looks at the number in the current stack and decides if it prints if it's odd or even. And then in the bytehook, I tell it hook function test in line number 2 inside the function, and insert a call to the function odd or even and pass it the state. You can opt to pass the state and it will put in the function the locals and globals, as you can see in the odd or even argument. And then when I run it again, you can see on the right side, before the number is printed, because I put it before line number 2, it actually prints even or odd. And then you can disable the hook point, and it will. And if you run test again, it won't print it in the third try, as you can see. Currently, the limitations, of course, is it can only modify pure Python functions, not functions which are written in C or uses the C API. And also, the modifications they affect only the next entry to the function. So if you have a loop that never exits, and you inject a hook while it's running, it won't load the changes. But if you're hooking into a function inside the loop that the loop calls, that will work on the next time it goes to it. And for now, it supports CPython 2.7, although it can easily be adapted to CPython 3. I haven't gotten to it yet. And it hasn't been thoroughly tested in all situations. Now, let's talk a bit about Pyrocyte. So Pyrocyte is a tool for injecting arbitrary code into running Python processes without taking them down. It's actually pretty easy. The premise is you attach to the target process using GDB or what tool you have. You acquire the global interpreter lock. And then the Python interpreter has a nice function called pyrun simple string, which you can put it a C string of your code. You can do import. You can do whatever Python you want. And the interpreter will run it. And then you release the interpreter lock. It's actually much more easier in Linux when you have GDB. It's a bit messier in Windows. I've ported this model to Windows and Mac. And the payload of Pyrocyte is actually running on a payload of a Python source code. The project, that's the address. It was started by Luke McCann. It has a built-in interesting payload, such as a reverse shell, dump memory, which can dump all the memory contents into JSON files, dump stacks of all the threads, dump all the models loaded, force the garbage collection, start and stop producing a call graph, and also it has a nice GUI. So here we can see a GTK-based GUI that's running on Linux, and you can see on the left side all the Python processes in the system, and on the right, you can get lots of views into them. This is the resource view. You can see the CPU usage, the memory usage, number of threads, network connections, I/O connections, open files, etc. You can also look at the stack traces of a given Python process. And also you can look at the objects view statistically. This is very nice in finding memory leaks and stuff like that. I return to the problem I started with. So we have this, let's say, code on the left that has an issue I want to investigate while it's running. So on the right, I just code a simple file which calls byte hook, and it tells it actually, as you can see, go to the main module, to the function logic. In line 6, if you don't give it a function, it implicitly runs import PDB, PDB set trace, and opens up the PDB debugger. And there you can see what happens. So the code I ran in the start, you have Python test py, it runs, it throws here randomly exceptions. And then on the right, I go in another shell, and I do pyrocyte and give the process ID, and I tell it to run the hook py. And then, as you can see, the next time the exception happens, actually, the PDB is opened, and I can do whatever I want in the process. I can look at the local variables, take the exception stack trace, and look at what the function arguments were, and basically do what I want. Another issue is I've talked about the PYC files. So let's just give a quick gotchas I've had while working on this on the PYC files. So the PYC files are actually the disk bytecode representations that are saved to save the compile time when you're reusing the code a lot, like libraries. The PYC file have a 4-byte magic number at the start, which it actually changes between the different Python versions, and it's the Python interpreter uses to check that you're running the correct PYC file with the correct interpreter, or else it deletes and recreates it. There is a 4-byte timestamp, which signifies the modification time of the original Python file, and it's used to check if the PYC needs to be recreated because the original PY file was modified. And then actually, it's just a big serialization of the code object, because the code object can contain, besides the functions, it also needs to represent how to create functions, how to create classes. So it encompasses all of the given model code object, serialized via the Marshall protocol. And a few gotchas I've had in production with PYC. So there is an environment flag in Python which you can set or give a flag to the Python interpreter called Python don't write bytecode. So once you have your frozen environment and everything is ready, you might want to consider disabling the creation of PYC. I ran in production and we deployed the code from source control. The resolution for the modified time is actually in seconds. And when you pull all your files from the source control, they're basically created in the same second because it's very fast. And then someone ran the system and found out the configuration file was wrong. So he did a move for the config file to another config file. And then he ran the system and it kept giving him weird stuff because all the files were created on the same second, it was actually using all the PYC file from the previous file because the resolution wasn't sufficient. So if you disable the creation, that wouldn't be an issue. Python 3, by the way, adds another check besides the modification time of the Python file. It also checks for the Python file size, but if they're both the same size, it won't help you. Also, another interesting and troublesome issue I had is actually Python 2 doesn't do I/O error checks when it compiles your PY file to PYC file. So if your code is stored in a remote NetApp and it has, it's maybe on Windows and you have tons of processes accessing the source code, it's very rare, but it happened to me a few times. The Python interpreter will produce valid PYC files, but because it had an I/O error while trying to read the PY file, those PYC files won't represent the PY files, and scary stuff happens, like the system just won't run because the PYC contain, it's not garbage, but it's not a representation of the source file. So what I did is just disable the creation of the PYC once I've frozen my environment, and those issues don't happen. Any questions? Okay, so the question was, if you turn Python to executable, can you still inject code? So basically, the answer is yes. When you usually do freeze of the Python files, it just zips or puts them in one file, but it's still the original PYC file inside. And as long as you have the PYC file or the PY file, you can always inject code. How does it work? You can. It's a bit short time frame to explain. You can come and talk to me later on. Okay. Thank you.